This program contains views and opinions that may not be suitable for all audiences. Audience discretion is advised.
Welcome to Thespian Talk, everybody. I am your host, Gomer the Ranting Thespian, and my co-host this week is the Omega.
How you doing, everybody?
Alrighty, and finally, we're going to have him on the show. We're going to have this show recorded, and it's going to go out like it is supposed to. How you doing, Mr. Mendo?
Well, you know, pretty good, you know, considering I am the internet's strongest man and all.
There you go.
Seriously, you're always tweeting, like, I just did 100 million lifts of weights and things and stuff, and I'm like, wow, that's really impressive.
Well, I figure all my friends are constantly tweeting about the video games they play. It's like, fuck, I have hobbies, too.
There you go. Yeah, some people tweet video games, you tweet weightlifting, I tweet soap operas. I'm mostly Tumblr, and then they go to Twitter and then Facebook, but... Okay, for those out there that have never heard of you, can you tell us a little bit about yourself here, Mendo?
Well, alright, I'm a former soldier turned video reviewer, part-time filmmaker on the side. These days, mostly I review... porn and My Little Pony, and I wish those two didn't overlap, but they do.
Oh dear.
Fucking bronies.
And if I sound a little weird, I'm actually fighting a spot of bronchitis at the moment.
Oh damn. Yeah, there's been sickness going on around here too, and my body is threatening to catch it. I'm saying no, not until after the show. No, fuck you. Oh god. All right, so how's you guys' week been?
Well, you know how it goes. Pretty good. I saw Dracula Untold with the missus.
Oh yeah, how was it?
I enjoyed it. I didn't go for if you take it as a strict Dracula biopic, you'll be disappointed. But if you just go to see a good vampire movie, you'll be entertained. I was entertained, so there you go.
Entertainment is good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I take it you and Hagen got to see the new Doctor Who.
Yes.
Yes. I did the little cheat. I did the live stream that airs the BBC over here, and all of that. So I got to watch it at the same time you guys did. I kind of liked it.
I'm reserving my opinion till when we record that part for Lesbian Talk, but not as bad as I thought it would be.
Yeah.
after last week.
Yeah, last week, that last part of last week, like, what the?
Let's hit you over the head with an abortion metaphor, because that's really weird.
Yeah.
All the time you spent doing that, you could have watched the South Park episode about transgender people.
Yes, I went and watched, I actually watched
that. I haven't watched South Park since, 2004, I've had to be honest.
Wow, it's been a while.
It's been a long time.
So,
but
yeah.
Was it there, the dramas? Was it, respectful, or was it, douchebaggery, or,
It was pretty respectful, all things considered.
Yeah.
Okay, that's all right, then.
I mean, and I've seen people just, they were complaining about it, they were bitching about it, and I'm sitting there like, okay, what is this episode about? Because knowing how some people will bitch about South Park, they could just not understand something. And one of the key things is it's Eric Cartman. We all know Cartman. We all know he is a 10-year-old little sociopathic Archie Bunker wannabe. And he's using for the sake of the show, he is basically faking coming out as a transsexual just so he doesn't have to poop with the boys, or just so he can poop in his own space.
Okay.
So in that sense, yeah, Cartman is a dick. And what makes it even worse, what makes it even more difficult to talk about in that sense, even though you know it's Cartman, he knows everything. He knows exactly what to say to get his way. And mm-hmm. These are all actual talking points and issues that transgender people do go through. But at the same time, it's tempered by – it's coming from Cartman, who is using this for his own advantage.
Now, I've got to say that I have a great deal of transgender friends.
Oh, yeah.
On social media. And I haven't heard anything from any of them about it. So I'm guessing if it actually was as bad as people on Tumblr have been saying, then someone would have, you know, posted something, or not to offend Tumblr, but someone would have posted something actually meaningful.
Well, yeah. Well, hey, you can offend
Plus,
Tumblr. I
plus, it
don't care.
turns out Dan's dad is actually Lord.
Yeah, there was that one too, and it's like that just came across as okay. Yeah, that came across more dramatic to me. Wasn't taking the piss at anything, and it was just, you know, more of a dramatic, just a
Yeah, this
dramatic
was
thing
like
that
from
Randy
the
does.
show where they all of the guys got like irradiated their testicles so they could get medical pot. And this is also, again, one of the last episodes that I saw back in 2004, which is, you know, basically Kenny becomes an equivalent to Terry Schiavo.
Yeah.
So this is the people that brought you all of this offense.
Yes. And if you take a moment, yeah, you know, you can be offended. You know, nobody's taking away your right to be offended. You have that right. You also have the right to, you know, you also have to take this and maybe analyze it a little bit. That's what you do, and that's what I did. I watched it, I thought back on it, and it's like I don't see it. And I really don't see where all of the offense is. The closest would be, well, obviously Cartman, because
Right.
he's Cartman. You know, I mean, it's just.
I mean, not being a transgender person myself, like I guess I could watch the episode and I probably wouldn't get offended because I am not in the position to be offended by that. But then again, like I said, a lot of people that I care about in my life, you know, some old, very old friends from like high school days and so on, you know, if they said this offends me, then I would take that seriously because, you know, I respect them and I respect their opinion. But in as much as none of them did, you know, I don't know. I don't know what to
Yeah.
say about that.
The basic gist of the episode, as it always is that Cartman's a dick.
Yeah. Cartman's a dick. He gets what's coming to him. And, you know, the end. You know. I think one of the things towards the end was they actually built like a third bathroom. They fashioned a janitor's closet into a third bathroom for Other by that point.
That's
And
kind of cool, I guess.
at the end, the principal was like, you know what? If you're going to use the bathroom, whichever one you feel comfortable, it doesn't matter. And if you're uncomfortable with all of this, if you don't like the fact that a person who identifies as male walks into the male restroom and they happen to have a vagina, you're uncomfortable with that, go use the other bathroom with all of the transphobic fuckers type thing. So, and yeah.
Although, quite honestly, can I just say that as a woman, what I really hate in the restroom is when people either are on their phone in the stalls, or there's like a million stalls and they come into the one like right next to mine.
Yeah.
I hate that. I'm like, we're not friends. Don't be next to me.
Yeah, that's just weird.
I mean,
I'm told the guys have a way of like, they leave like a urinal buffer. I want that in the women's restroom. I want a buffer.
Yeah, and there's even I've even had like issues with like, you know, I would be in the restroom, I'd be trying to do my business in the urinal. Some guy would just come and start talking to me. I'm like, dude.
Don't do that. Like I know the guys don't do that. I wish the girls didn't do that. Don't talk to me. We're not friends. It's like pee time. It's not playtime.
It's like,
That's how
no,
I feel.
thank you. I have my hands on my dick peeing into a urinal. And you know, when I'm done, we can have a few words. Right now, I have more important issues to worry about. I mean, points for friendliness, but dial it back a little bit.
Don't talk to people in the bathroom.
Yes, please,
That's not
no.
how that goes.
Oh, God. And for me, that was a holy hell, that was a callback for me, because
The only the o
I actually have an old rant where I went on about men's restroom etiquette.
The all right, there's a corollary to that, and I have to say that if this is like the international girl code, like if another girl needs like a tampon or a sanitary and they don't have one and you do, then you should give it to them because that's the rules. But other than that, don't talk to me. I'm peeing right now.
Makes sense.
Just
That makes
saying.
sense. Oh, so with that, let's go ahead and head on to our shout-outs.
Woohoo.
For me, I actually have one over on Kickstarter. It's called Planet of the Ultraviolets,
Ooh.
which was actually shown to me by London Andrews, who is an erotic photographer, if you will. Well, photography, I guess. Erotic model. She's not necessarily doing porn. She's done porn, but that's not what she's doing now. And reading directly from the Kickstarter page, Planet of the Ultraviolets is a mixed-media short film that delves into the world of a tribe of free-spirited fluorescent people who are attacked by an invading flock of eyeballs that feast on color. It expands on the ultraviolet world of our previous award-winning short, Plasticity 3D. And if you look at it, just go on Kickstarter, look for Planet of the Ultraviolets by Ryan Suits. You'll find it there. You'll find the videos there. And London Andrews herself, the reason why she shared it around is she is in it. And there are pictures of her in here, and she looks really awesome.
So, is she an eyeball or is she ultraviolet?
She is ultraviolet.
It's a good question to ask.
Yes, very good question to ask. But yeah, and if you like it, you know, throw money at it. As it stands now, they've got $1,386 of their $3,000 goal, and they got about 32 days left to go. It'll be about 31 by the time this actually goes up. But yeah, again, Kickstarter, just look for Planet of the Ultraviolets. Omega, do you have one?
Yes, I do, actually. Mine is also a Kickstarter. Mm-hmm. If you are familiar with White Wolf's World of Darkness, you know that they sold, they licensed some of their products to Onyx Path Publishing, which have been doing new versions of the old stuff and reprints. Well, they did Vampire V20, the 20th anniversary of Vampire a few years back. Mm-hmm. And now they are going in for the V20 update for Dark Ages. So Vampire the Dark Ages. And I know the developer. He's a really great guy. He's a friend of mine's husband. So if you go on Kickstarter and search Vampire the Dark Ages V20, that should pop right up. And I just want to preface, they have hit their goal and then some. So they are well-funded. But if you do want some of the rewards, if you want some of the old PDFs, if you want the new book, definitely throw some money their way.
Sweet. Yes, and of course, as with all of our shoutouts, we will have the links below. Mendo, do you have a shoutout?
I have two, actually.
Okay.
First is the one I tried to make last time, but there was the whole recording snafu. It's a website. It's called blackgirlnerds.com. And there's a lot of very fascinating articles about geek culture from the perspective of women and people of color. And I think it's a wonderful site. I think it's something that people should go to and read a lot of their stuff. I think, you know, it really contributes a lot to the conversation of what's going on out there in geek media from a fresh perspective. Mm-hmm. And on the whole, I just support it.
Sweet.
And also, just a couple minutes ago, actually, I was contacted on Facebook by a gentleman by the name of Michael Budd. He was an actor in The Matrix. He's been in a movie with Henry Cavill. He is also a director, and his movie, Love of My Life, which is a horror movie, was made in Australia, came out in England last year, just came out on Hulu today. And the reason I'm pimping it is not only because it looks like it's a really cool movie, but because the script for it was written by none other than the Agni Boost Cheap Arts film critic, Liam Barrett.
Sweet.
Oh, I was wondering when that would come out. Yeah, Liam's a great guy.
Mm-hmm. Great writer, too. He's actually the guy who inspired me to not only write a script that I'm shopping around right now, but also to actually work on the two film projects that I'm making right now that I still have to find a composer and, you know, raise money for. But we're getting off track here. But basically, this looks like it's going to be an awesome movie. The director was very gracious when he contacted me. He asked me to help promote it here in America. Liam's a great guy, and so I included the link to Hulu, so you should go watch it. Watch it 4 or 5 times.
Yes, it'll be awesome. Yeah. So there we go. And with that, that is our shout-outs for this week. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we have to go to the news. We have some good, we have some bad, and we have some pants on head stupid.
It's all the news.
It's time for the news.
Yes. Oh, my holy God.
I know, right? I was just thinking that.
All right. Gresham, Oregon. A man practicing his open carry right was robbed of the gun he was openly carrying.
You idiot!
William Coleman III was robbed of his Walter Brand P-22 just after 2 a.m. October 4th, happy birthday to me, in Gresham by a man who asked him for it, and flashed his own weapon as persuasion.
But you had the gun! All you had to do was say no. I have a gun too, you see.
Yeah. Coleman, 21, was talking to his cousin on the 17200 block of whatever street after purchasing the handgun earlier that day, when a young man asked him for a cigarette, police said. The man then asked about the gun, pulled a gun from his own waistband, and said, "I like your gun. Give it to me." Coleman handed over the gun and fled on foot. Suspect is black male, between 19 and 23, clean cut, small patch of facial hair, yada yada yada. Roughly 6 feet tall. The weapon he used in the robbery was described as possibly semi-automatic, as a possibly semi-automatic black gun, Gresham police said. So...
You have failed the point of open carry.
You have. Because like, isn't it supposed to be able to, you know, draw your own weapon and defend yourself?
Yeah, that's the thing. It's supposed to be like, you know, stand your ground and defend yourself in case, like, somebody comes up. Like, they say, oh, well, the only thing that will defend against a bad guy with a gun was a good guy with a gun. You were the good guy, and you failed.
Yeah.
Superman is disappointed in you.
Very much like, so.
So just remember, kids, when somebody asks you if they can have your gun, the answer is no.
Like, isn't that the point? Isn't that the point of open carry? Like, oh, no. Someone's going to come and take our guns. Well, someone did. That's when yeah. you say no. That's... You already have the gun.
Yeah, you have it. Now,
it's
now,
so
the way,
bad.
And the way it is the way it seems is like the guy, I don't know if he was had his gun ready. Or...
I bet he didn't know how to use it. I bet he just, well, it even says in the story, he just got it. I bet he didn't even know how to shoot or anything like that. Give me your gun. Oh, no, he has a gun and I'm scared. You've got a gun. It's like that scene in Aladdin. He's got a sword. You idiots. We've all got swords.
Yeah.
Oh.
Like, dude,
you deserved it. You deserved to have your gun taken from you because you did not know how to use it.
Yeah, Mr. Coleman, you fail. I'm sorry. You just fail. And this whole open carry, and this idea of open carry, bad guy with a gun, good guy with a gun thing. Yeah. That doesn't take into account guys like him. And
but it happened. There was the bad guy right there.
Yeah.
Why didn't you do something?
And here's another thing. Here's another thing. You know, even if he had the gun out and he was ready to swing up and possibly shoot, the other guy already had the gun trained on him. So he could have been shot while he was trying to defend himself.
Well, but still.
So that good guy with the gun would not have stopped that bad guy with the gun.
I'm just saying.
But you know what would really be funny, though? Mm-hmm. Is if the guy who took his gun was named Clinton.
Oh, that would be great. Oh, God.
Oh, this next one's a long one.
Yeah. Alrighty, so the next one. Oh, boy. Two North Carolina pastors speculated recently that former President Jimmy Carter may be going to hell because he had said that Jesus would not condemn LGBT people. While speaking to students at Grand Rapids Community College last month, Carter had responded to a question about LGBT rights. Never knew of any word or action of Jesus Christ that discriminated against anyone, the former president said, adding that discrimination based on sexual orientation was like prejudice against a person for their skin color or financial status.
I like Jimmy Carter. He always looks like, you know, someone like, you know, your old great uncle that would tell you stories and then, like, give you peanuts when you were four.
There you go.
Andy was on The Simpsons.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's okay.
Yeah.
You have offended me, sir. Get back here. Why are you yellow belly?
In an online sermon, quote-unquote sermon, for the...
An online sermon.
For the Berean Baptist Church in Fayetteville, North Carolina, senior pastor Sean Harris and student pastor David McManus expressed outrage for Carter's remark. McManus began by reminding listeners who Carter was. Plenty of times, people criticize our current president, saying it's the worst president since Jimmy Carter, he said. So he seems to be that modern benchmark of at least mediocrity as far as a president goes. And then to be followed up by Ronald Reagan, who was, you know, almost wildly successful and pretty, you know, idolized by so many. Yeah, I'm going to be looking more into Jimmy Carter's term in office. And if Obama and Jimmy Carter are that similar, it makes me wonder how much Republican obstructionism was going on during Carter's administration.
I don't know, actually, because that predated me, personally. I mean, I probably could Google it, but, you know.
Yeah.
Basically, Jimmy Carter was the result of what would have happened if anybody but Bush had actually worked in 2004.
Oh, dear. So we would have just had four more years of mediocrity.
But here's the thing, though. Isn't that a good thing in terms of a president? Because, I mean, so I know some people that were very, very anti-Clinton. And I said, but look at it this way. At least he didn't fuck shit up.
Yeah. He fucked someone. but
well, okay, but that's between him and that woman. But
yeah.
Here's the thing, though. Like, the best thing you can say about a president is, well, at least he didn't fuck shit up.
There you go. And
I mean, I thought the point of being president was to fuck around.
Well,
well, if you're single and you're in that kind of a
fuck
relationship.
Fuck around, like, genital-wise, not, like, foreign policy nuke-wise.
Yeah, at least...
Get a BJ. Don't drop a nuke.
There you go.
That's my new slogan.
Get a BJ. Don't drop a nuke.
Exactly. That's like George Carlin used to say, make fuck, not kill.
There you go.
Mm-hmm.
McManus argued that Carter had been wrong to liken skin color to sexual orientation because a person's skin color could not be suppressed. We'll embrace the hippie, you know. Jesus loves everybody kind of picture of Christ and ignore the fact that, you know, it was very exclusive in who he dealt with and who was in the kingdom, as McManus opined.
That's like the opposite of what happened in the Bible.
Yeah.
Jesus, like, took in, like, all sorts of people. And like, you know, at least as far as I recall.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, there was that whole thing about how you should reject your family if they don't follow him, but, you know, other than that.
Yeah. We're just kind of, but... You know, hey, you know what? If we're going to cherry pick from Jesus' teachings, well, that's one thing. That's one cherry we.
Yeah, but there was that. Was the time he, like, freaked the fuck out in the church, though? Because
oh,
there
yeah.
were money changers. And he was like, shut the fuck up. I hate you. Ugh. I'm like, so angry. I'm Jesus. Jeez.
And he's like, get the fuck out.
Although, but sounding less like Napoleon Dynamite there. I'm not sure why that happened.
I'm just saying.
Yeah.
God, man.
God.
Jesus, Rabbi. I mean, man.
Well, you can't have any of my fish. I didn't eat anything today.
Mm-hmm. I mean, like, I guess I could, like, make fishes and loaves, but, oh, it's so much work.
Oh.
You don't even have cool nunchuck skills.
I think the Bible would be so improved by cool nunchuck skills. I mean, I'm just saying.
There we go.
Just saying.
The Bible, the Michelangelo version.
Yes.
That would be awesome. Yes. We need to make this a reality.
Somebody get on that.
Yes.
Oh, my God. Can you imagine if there was, like, a version of the TMNT theme song for the disciples?
Yes!
Their heroes
Somebody.
And their sandals, and they're clean.
Yes.
Dog leads, Paul does machines.
Someone needs to write.
Dude, give me a break. Well, Peter the Lesser is a party dude.
Yes.
I think that we should get D.A. Scott Jr. to collaborate with Zach from Indie Christian Review when they can write one.
There you go.
That'd be great.
Oh, yes. So, but skip down the story a little bit. But what really upset the pair of pastors was that Carter was using his credentials as a born-again Southern Baptist to push equal rights for gay and lesbian Americans. I can't make an argument for homosexual equality from the perspective of atheism and evolution, McManus opined, because somehow if you did evolve into a homosexual species, you would cease to exist immediately because you wouldn't reproduce. So what do I have to do? I have
this vision of, like, the thing with, like, you know, the monkey and then Homo erectus and Homo habilis and, you know, that got to modern man, but, like, you have, like, the chimp and then all of a sudden the chimp is... wearing lipstick, and then the other chimp is, like, all butch with a flannel. It would be great. Evolution of the homosexual.
Evolution of the homosexual. Just this one article alone, I have, like, three or four different ideas for show titles. Holy shit.
Just say.
But, yeah, he says, God, you know, but I have to go the God route and say God made me this way. That's why we have so many, quote, unquote, gay Christians. Because that's the route that need to take, he continued. I think he's meaning that they need to take. And Carter is the perfect mouthpiece for that position. Such unfortunate wording. Ugh. Harris said that it was irresponsible of Carter to promote a behavior that's never produced a single child, to promote a behavior that's clinically has been proven to be bad for your health, every aspect, to promote a behavior that is credited with worldwide epidemic of a disease, AIDS. Omega?
Why does everyone... Okay, there's the problem that I have. Like, when everyone's like, oh no, it's the gays. Like, it's always about the penises. You know? Like, there's... Alright, leaving aside the fact that there's gay adoption. Alright, that's fine. Lesbians can have babies, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, it does take a sperm, but, you know, there's ways to get the sperm.
Yeah,
You
what
know,
about?
either by actually having intercourse with a man or you go to a clinic or something like that. And there's experiments in Europe where like they could take the zygote of the egg of your partner and you mean you would always be a girl, but you know, technically you could reproduce that way. It's always just like that behavior doesn't produce children. Just stop being so penis-centric. Because you notice this is always about it's always about gay men. I don't know why. It's never about lesbians because I guess maybe there's less to hate. I don't know. Maybe they think that two girls is hot while two penises is ick, two pe peni. Is that right?
Penises.
Peni, penises. Two peni are icky. I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah, because they're the basic straight homophobic white old crusty motherfuckers. Because they don't understand that some people may find two guys banging their dicks together hot. They only
That's not how
understand.
it works. I know that much.
I know that too, but.
You know what that is? That's basically that old Andrew Dice Clay routine where he was like, "And don't give me none of this shit about women want to have an orgasm. It's only been like the last 5 years y'all figured that out, okay?"
Oh, and also bear in mind, Harris, back in 2012, he was criticized after he advocating beating gay children. Yeah, with this quote, "Dads, the second you see your son dropping the limp wrist, you walk over there and crack that wrist. Man up, give them a good punch, okay? You're not going to act like that. You were made by God to be male, and you're going to be a male." Oh God, and that's having shades of South Park. I know that's where they got that particular pastor from. God wants you to be a
Jesus.
man, and so like a paper clip, he takes you and bends you and makes you straight. It's like, no, this guy, and
If God cared that much, he'd get involved personally. I mean, seriously, people.
yeah.
I mean, it's basically like The Sims, okay? You know what? If you were fucking up that much, God would get involved personally.
Yeah, definitely.
Well,
Just like the
no, you see,
just like in the
it's not like The Sims, because if it was The Sims, there would be more lesbians.
That's true.
They're true.
It's just like the documentary A Touch by an Angel. If you fuck up enough, a big sassy angel and a kind of look gayish angel and Roma Downey will come and straighten you
There you go. But that's not happening. Homosexuality is a thing. These guys can go fuck themselves. Speaking of fucking,
as we often are.
yes, a
I
rand,
like fucking.
yeah, a randy burglar was caught after he had sex with a teddy bear while raiding a shed, and police discovered his DNA inside the toy.
Can't you wait?
You know what's sad is that in my mind, these two stories are related. Because there used to be a rapper who called himself Gangsta Fag.
Really?
What?
Yeah,
Really?
he was trying to be the first queer core, hardcore gangster rapper, but it turns out he's actually straight and he felt really guilty about doing it. But there's a song that's called He Wants It, and on looking at the lyrics right here, "I knew I was done when I started getting soft. I grabbed the kid's toy and wiped my dick off."
Well then.
Yep, I'm including the link because this is. I'm sorry to say, I know what he was going for, but this guy is a shit rapper, man. He
Oh, damn.
has no flow at all. I'm glad he's not rapping anymore.
There you go. Paul Mountain, 38, said he was coming down from amphetamines and felt an overwhelming need for sexual relief, the Lancashire Telegraph reports. It's believed he cut a hole inside the defenseless bear before getting down to business. Of course, the bear is defenseless. It's an inanimate object.
Why, hello?
Oh no. Teddy Ruxpin, what's on your mouth? Where have you been? Oh,
"I
Teddy.
love you. Can we do that again, but from behind?"
Oh no, Teddy.
Oh. Blackburn Magistrates Court heard that the owner of an allotment found a shed of an allotment found a shed that had been broken into and the contents were spread all around. On the floor among the wreckage, she found the teddy bear used and abused.
Served like hell to one day you was found hung dead in the cell. It was plain to see that your life was lost. You was cold and your body swung back and forth. But now your eyes sing the sad song of how you lived so fast and died so young. So don't push me, cause I'm close to the edge." Wow, that is an ingrained response.
Of course, the teddy bear was past the police. They found a semen in there, and I just gotta say, dude, There have been times I've gone without whether sex or some kind of sexual release, and usually it's when I'm on the road for a decent amount of time without the opportunity to relieve myself. That happens sometimes, just saying.
Dude, just wait.
Exactly.
Just wait till you're not doing something.
Yeah, and you know what? If you really must get off while you are burgling someplace, clean up and take the
Just
goddamn
take
bear
it with
with
you.
you.
Like, I'm just we there's so many different versions of CSI on TV. You have no excuse for not knowing how DNA works. I mean, I don't like as I often say, I don't have a penis, I don't know how it works. But like, if you, I guess if you can't wait, just shit, just CSI that motherfucker. I mean, just
Well, I mean, I can certainly sympathize because there have been times when I've really been jonesing to have some cookies, and when I couldn't get any, I fucked a teddy bear.
I don't even have a teddy bear here to fuck, so
Well,
thankfully.
I've got millions.
Oh, there's probably fanfic of that out there now, just because you said it.
There's that explosion there. That's fan fiction.
Well, if there's fanfic about me, I'll read it on the show. Just putting that out there.
There you go. And our next one, hi Comcast. Comcast, you're a bunch of dicks.
I heard about this.
Yeah, innovative might not be the first word that comes to mind in describing Comcast, but we are giving the comp but are we giving the company credit where credit is due? Let's face it. After that harrowing 18-minute customer service call went viral in July, it looked like Comcast had nothing more to strive for. It had reached peak horrible. Yet, if reports this week are accurate, Comcast has continued to shine as an innovator in the competitive field of corporate terribleness. It got a customer's employer to fire him for complaining about shoddy customer service. The full story in all its sadistic glory is at the consumerist, I can read, I swear, but here's the SparksNotes version. A customer named Conal started subscribing to Comcast service early in 2013. There were issues, erroneous charges, bills that never arrived, discounts that weren't applied. Conal considered canceling his service, but decided to stick with it after a Comcast rep promised that the issues would be resolved and threw in some free perks. As another friendly gesture, the company also allegedly sent and billed Conal for $1,820 of equipment he had never ordered. This is where it gets crazy. Conal, understandably frustrated, decided to bypass the customer service department and take his complaint straight to the Comcast controller. During the call, he claims, he suggested that a private sector oversight group look into Comcast billing and accounting issues. Shortly after that call, Comcast contacted Conal's employer, a large accounting firm that Consumerist reports happened to be doing business with Comcast. The rep claimed that Conal name-dropped his employer as leverage during the call. According to the story, the firm opened an investigation report. Against Conal, rather, and then fired him from his job.
Now, I saw an update to this that they issued an apology and they said they're looking into it, and but the it wasn't the Consumers, it was another magazine that had that story, but his company would not provide information when they request an interview. So it sounds like this was totally dirty, and everybody knows it, is what it sounds like to me.
Yeah, it's like, just firing somebody, getting somebody fired because they're complaining. Oh my God. And you know what? You know what? This makes me wonder. Everybody who has a problem with Comcast, why doesn't everybody do this en masse? Fuck the customer service, go straight over the top of heads, because they can't get everybody fired. Because if everybody gets fired, nobody's going to be working. And if nobody's working, you're not going to have that little income coming in. So, I mean, I would do it,
Comcast
but
sucks. Verizon Fios is very good, so that's what I have to say about that.
yeah, I would do it myself, but we use AT&T. Although, if you have problems with your other carriers as well, that might also be another thing.
We use Vodafone here. Vodafone's been pretty good so far.
Sweet. But yeah.
Contribute to that. I said I have nothing to contribute to that. I'm sorry.
That's all right. It happens. Oh, the next story.
Never happened before, I swear.
take a shot, everybody. Next story is out of Jupiter, Florida.
It's Florida.
Yes, a Florida construction worker was taken to the hospital after a 300-pound Bengal tiger bit off his finger Monday.
Which finger?
I have no idea. No,
They
no,
should
it
have
does say
said.
no, it does say later on. Okay. The tiger is one of several exotic animals housed in cages at a private residence and ranch in the ranch colony community in Jupiter Farms. He approached the cage and put his hand in, and the tiger bit his thumb off, said property manager Jason Frain. There are signs on the cage that say, "Do not approach the cage."
Now, here's what I want to know. How exactly was he holding his hand that the tiger, A, went for his thumb, and B, that was the only finger it got? Because the thumb was very small.
I'm gonna guess that it was just luck. I'm going to chalk it
Was
up
a
to
he was a
luck.
very accurate tiger.
Yeah.
A very well-trained tiger.
I think I know what happened. He basically walked up to the tiger and said, "Hey, tiger, let's play a fun game. Let's each pick a finger and try to kill each other with it. I choose the thumb. It's the daddy finger."
And Tiger just said, "Fuck you,
Tiger's like,
no."
"Who's your daddy?" "Oh, no."
But you know,
That's
there's a
just
fun
like.
there's a there's a silver lining to this story. From now on, as a fun party trick, and you'd be like, "Who's only got one thumb and got bit by a tiger? This guy."
There you go.
Well, it's just like when you sent me this story, I thought it was going to be like, oh, a tiger got free from a private residence and bit the shit out of this guy. Like, how stupid do you have to. Okay, like, things that you don't expect to bite you. Like, you could, maybe stick your finger in the cage like a hamster or a frog or like a parrot or something. But it's a fucking tiger. Like, that's what it does. It bites.
Yeah, that's what it does. That's why when you go to like zoos and these sanctuaries, they tell you to keep your hand out. Tiger, yeah,
This
it's a
will
big
bite
kitty.
you.
It is a
It's
big
big
kitty.
and it's angry.
Yeah, a big angry fucking kitty, and it will eat you. You are food. To that kitty, you are food, sir. And it got your thumb, and it
It's like
probably enjoyed it.
I follow Big Cat Rescue on Facebook, and if use the secret shout out, if you want to subscribe to them, they're really great.
Yes.
But they operate completely as a sanctuary. And the one of the videos they had up, I think it was two like Russian lynxes enjoying pumpkins, for Halloween because they give them enrichment and stuff like that. And one of the lynxes, huge, huge cats, was nuzzling up on the bars, the chain link fence, and you could hear one of the keepers saying, "I don't trust you. You're up to no good. I don't trust that purring." Because it's right, like even regular cats will bite you.
Yeah. He's like, nom, 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 nom. Yeah, this is why you don't pet the tiger. I know it's a kitty, I know it's adorable, but you are food! Like I said, you are food!
All I gotta say is I give this story two thumbs up.
Nicely
Which is more than the guy can
done,
give.
sir. Nicely done.
Yes. And now we go on the other side of the Gulf. Corpus Christi. This one, oh God. Prosecutors played a shocking recording of Ken Davis as he admitted to police detectives that he killed his mother. It's not even the worst of it. This started day one of the punishment phase after he pled guilty to murder just as his trial was getting underway on Monday. He admitted to killing his mother, Kimberly Hill, inside her Corpus Christi apartment. He was found at a residence on County Road 61 after he knocked on the door of a random residence, telling the person there that he needed help because he had just killed someone. In the recorded interview with the homicide detectives following his arrest, he tells in frighteningly calm detail the manner of how he killed his mother. He says how he tried to strangle her with a power cord of a video game console, but she was still screaming. He then quickly got a hammer and struck her in the head several times in the back of the, well, struck her several times in the back of the head. He then put his hand inside her open head wound to remove her brain to ensure she was dead.
Well, Jesus.
That.
Oh, wait, what video game console did he have that still had cords?
All right.
I don't know.
It could have been the power cord.
Yeah. Well, it was a
Maybe.
power cord.
Oh.
Yeah. So, yeah.
It's a sale at Penny's. Yeah, that was
And
a rare thing to say.
it gets even worse. Davis says he wasn't done with his mother yet, and what he admits next is beyond description. So, of course, they describe it in the very next paragraph.
I know, I was about to be like, of course they tell you, though.
Yeah. He tells investigators in calm detail that he had sexual intercourse with his dead mother.
Right now, I'm just picturing Dr. Forster from Mystery Science Theater 3000. He's like, oh, sure, we all thought about it, but I had the guts to do it.
And my first thought is, dude, Oedipus Complex, you are doing it wrong. Seriously, no.
There's so many kinds of fucked up in this.
There
I
is.
Mean, because I saw the story earlier in the week on Reddit, and I was like, Jesus.
Oh, it gets worse.
Yeah. Officers ask him if it was his first time. Davis admits that it was his first time, and deadpans, guess I lost my virginity to a dead corpse.
As opposed to a living corpse, mind you.
Exactly.
Pretty much.
And just, dude, what the fuck?
He ain't never getting out of jail.
No. And the jury did hand down a life sentence. And he is sitting in prison right now. Just thankfully he is in prison for just being horrendous and oh God, dude, Oedipus Complex, you did it wrong.
There's got to be so much wrong with that family.
Oh my God, I would hate to see what everybody else in the family is saying. They'll probably just be that one family member that goes to visit him out of pity. And then everybody else is just going to be like, yeah, you're there in the prison there. We're going to move over to West Texas, and we're going to get as far away from you as possible.
That's the part where you just don't talk about that cousin anymore.
Yeah.
He's dead to you.
Yeah.
I think this is probably going to get blamed on video games, though.
If it gets blamed on video games, I will fucking...
But there's no incest video game. It's like, okay... You know, back in the day, you could be like, oh, Grand Theft Auto 3, you could kill a stripper and things and stuff. There's no, like, Oedipus Complex the game.
No.
On Steam.
The closest that you could get to incest in video games is fucking Pokemon. That is the closest.
Sir, I do not funk Pokemon, I will have you know. Just saying.
No, you're thinking of Twinzest.
That works, too. Oh, and everybody out there who has played Pokemon knows exactly what I'm talking about. Oh, speaking of video games, a Turkish boy has been killed in a tragic accident after a sacrificial goat jumped off the roof of his nearby apartment building, landing on him in the street below. Goat Simulator, you're doing it wrong.
How does that happen? I mean, I know how it happens, but who sacrifices goats? I mean,
yeah, because.
Well, I know someone must because it happened, but I mean, like,
mm-hmm.
Is it like you can put that on Facebook as an event? Goat sacrifice
well,
tonight?
Depending on which version of Islam you follow, you're supposed to sacrifice a goat whenever you get a new house.
Oh, really? Hmm. This I did not know.
Oh, well, I went to high school with a girl whose family did that when she moved into her new house.
Okay. I couldn't do it. They can do it. They can have that. That's their thing, as long as they don't just, like, chunk the goat, I hope.
I guess you can eat, if you eat it, though, like, afterwards. Because you can eat goat meat.
Yeah.
Sacrilegious.
Heval Yildrim was playing with his friends during the weekend's Ed Al Hada festival when the accident occurred. His father, Mehmet, brought the goat and stored it on... storied it on the roof because there was not enough room in their apartment. Storied it! Okay. Article. I know what you're going for. But there is a thing called an editing process. Please, next time, do better. Told the police that the terrified animal had vaulted the fence of its small roof enclosure before it fell. Extreme Goat Simulator!
You know what this was? This was a kamikaze goat.
There you go.
If he was going down, he was taking every motherfucker with him.
Yeah. And...
Yeah, I realize now how this is connected to video games, because clearly they were playing Angry Goats.
Angry Goats. Oh, God. Oh, Lordy. But, yeah, it's like, feel bad for the family, but, yeah, Goat Simulator Extreme. It's not something to play with the kids. Just not. Next one is out of Indianapolis. Have you ever gotten to the airport and been a little confused about where to go and what to do? Officials at the Indianapolis International Airport want to help, with an unusual addition to their staff that could be rolling up to travelers soon. It's a mobile customer service agent, one they've dubbed the Double Robot. A human customer service representative controls the robot from a desk on the fourth floor. They're able to stay mobile throughout the terminal, answering questions from guests through a FaceTime-style feature on the onboard iPad. Right now, the robot doesn't have a name. The airport is having an employee contest to come up with one. I think this is a good idea.
Dude, I was like, that actually sounds kind of cool.
Yeah.
Yep. I have this niggling down the back of my mind that somehow they're going to come up with an even lamer name than Double Robot.
Double Robot, what does it mean?
Oh my god.
I just had to do that.
God damn it, Double Robot. I'm tired of your lone wolf attitude and your disrespect for the rules. You're off the case.
Turn in your iPad.
There you go.
It's like when a priest goes rogue. Turn in your collar.
Bless your heart.
There you go.
I want to make a movie about a rogue priest.
What? We must do so.
It'll be like that telenovela that was on King of the Hill.
Oh. Hmm. Oh, Lordy. So, our next one. Out of Mobile, fucking Alabama. By the way, Mobile is about a 2-3 hour drive from me. Hmm. Mother of a 5-year-old girl who attends E.R. Dixon School in Mobile, Alabama, claims that her daughter was forced to sign a contract in school stating that the girl would not commit suicide or kill anyone else, as reported on Friday by the local ABC TV affiliate.
I heard about this.
I would just like to say that without her mother present, that contract is not valid.
There you go.
That's what everyone on the thread on Facebook said.
Yes. I think that's what everybody everywhere says. The mother, who refused to give her complete name, said that school officials were sending her daughter home from school after an incident involving a crayon and a drawing involving the insinuation of a gun. Prior to sending the girl home, however, she was told to sign the contract about suicide and homicide.
Now, I will say that in the psychological psychiatric field, when a patient has expressed suicidal or homicidal ideation, then we have what we call a contract for safety, where we said, can you assure us that you will not harm yourself or another? And if the person does, we write in the intake notes, can contract for safety. If they do not, that could be one factor leading to an admission. But these are patients and not 5-year-olds.
Exactly. The mother said that school officials told her that her daughter, Elizabeth, drew something that resembled a gun. Additionally, it was said that the little girl pointed a crayon at another student and said, pew, pew! This incident, according
to... But guns don't go pew, but guns go bang. Obviously, she was making a laser.
Yes. This incident, according to the mother, led to her daughter being given a questionnaire which is designed to evaluate the girl for possible suicidal thoughts. Beyond that, the girl was given a Mobile County Public School safety contract to sign. The contract says that the person signing it, 5-year-old Elizabeth, would not kill herself or anyone else. Elizabeth's mother, Rebecca, is outraged over the way the school handled the situation, as well she should be.
I think she should sue. I mean, I'm just saying.
Yeah. The mother said that they made her daughter sign the contract about suicide and homicide while she waited in the school's lobby. She asserts that there should be a different way to handle such a situation. She is quoted as saying, there should be a different way to handle this. If this is protocol, it needs to be looked at again. Mother went on to say, this isn't right. She's 5 years old. Most of the words on this document, she's never heard in her life. She said, my child interrupted us and said, what's suicide, mommy?
Aw.
That
you're a little lumpkin.
That is the point where you have gone too far, schools. Gun safety?
It's
sure.
So, it didn't used to be like this when I was young. Mendo, you're my age, right? Like, was this like this where you grew up? Because it wasn't for me.
Well, my experience is a little skewed because for the first half of my life, I went to school on Air Force bases.
Oh, that's a good point.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I didn't have to sign a contract saying I wasn't going to kill myself, but my first day in school, the counselor called my parents to ask if they worshipped Satan because I was clearly possessed by the devil.
What?
Apparently,
nice.
Apparently, I was too smart to be 6 years old.
Wow, you know,
Jesus.
You know, I was actually you know, I didn't go to school in military
But why would
bases,
they
but
think that, like, why would they think that that was a result of satanic influence, though?
apparently, and
This.
I have no memory of this. This is the part of the incident that I don't remember, but my parents swear it's true, is that I was sitting underneath a table and the teacher was trying to get me out, and apparently I said, "I can sue you if you touch me."
Well then,
I
that
honestly don't
is
remember that part.
a bad little child.
Because, oh
No,
my
I
God, you
just
know your rights.
ADHD real bad and we didn't know about it.
That's just such a it's so such a weird conclusion to draw. Not like, is one of your parents a lawyer, but are your parents worshiping Satan?
Right, because only Satan would bestow upon a child, you know, the knowledge of the legal system.
The Dark Lord has taught you your constitutional rights.
I mean, I know lawyers are stereotypically scum of the earth, but goddamn.
No. Well,
I
and just.
think it would help clarify things if I explained that the school counselor at the place where I went to first grade, she was basically church lady from Saturday Night Live.
Oh.
Yes, that's lovely. You know who it reminds me of? Satan.
Oh boy. Now, I didn't go to school in like Air Force bases. I'm a military brat, but I didn't go like on the bases or anything. I actually went to the public schools. And I too, you know, I was proven to be smarter than the other kids. You know what they did to me? They just put me in an advanced class. So,
Yeah, they gave me like a different reading book than the rest of the class.
Yeah,
We
and
didn't. And like we ran around with sticks all the time, thwacking each other. You know,
Oh yeah.
like the first thing we did when we learned about the Revolutionary War is we played redcoats and freedom fighters in, you know, the playground. Because that's what kids do. That's what boys do. That's what girls do. You know, it's just it really annoys me. It's like the kid who bit his Pop-Tart into a gun and they wanted to, you know, suspend. It's just so, just stop now.
Yeah,
Just
it's
enough of
just
this.
Also of concern is the fact that minors cannot legally sign a contract in the state of Alabama, according to the Sun News. The extremely disgruntled parent is trying to get documentation of the incident removed from her little girl's records, right?
As well, she should.
Yes. Beyond the school's unusual handling of the incident, the mother says that school officials requested that her daughter see a psychiatrist because she pew pew. You need to see a psychiatrist.
See, this is a very unfortunate consequence of Columbine. It really is. Because any natural. I mean, kids are violent. I mean, you know, even my little sister, she was very violent with me, and I couldn't be violent back. But kids are violent. That's just what they do. But that's not an issue for the mental health, you know, for mental health services to get involved. The child has not displayed anything that's unusual for age. She seems to be developing normally, from what I can tell from the story. The idea that something that you don't like is mental illness really annoys me.
Yeah, it's just, oh, God damn it. No, it does not work this way. Fuck you, Mobile schools. And by the way, the mother did refuse permission. Yeah,
Good.
she refused to give permission for that to happen.
If you're the
So,
mom, write the show. We'll help you
yes,
out.
yes. Or hell, you know what? You're 3 hours away. We'll bring you in. Shit. All right, so our last story, and I wanted to end this on a slightly lighter note. A woman staying, by the way, take another shot at Florida. Woman staying at a Key West resort was bitten by an iguana there Wednesday night, but the reptile nipped her toe because she harassed the iguana to the point of angering it, according to a city police report.
They actually don't have teeth, but they do have really sharp mouth ridges. And I know this because I used to work at a summer camp in the nature hut and one bit me.
Yeah.
So.
It's not clear who called police to the Coconut Malloy, Mallory, Mallory rather, resort, but Amy Russell, 39, reportedly from Alabama, where apparently they don't have iguanas, told police the iguana bit her toe and she feared contracting salmonella. Salmonella, whatever the hell it's called. But from
Then you
Alabama.
just get some peroxide, you know?
Yeah.
Like wash that out, you know?
Yeah. Let's see. Amy Russell from Alabama. Gee, I wonder, are you from Mobile by any chance? Are you on the school board in Mobile County? Most iguanas are wild and the resort doesn't own the bright green medium-sized iguana, Officer Brenda Sellers wrote in her report. Also, iguanas generally stay away from humans and rarely bite. Sellers wrote in her report that Russell, upon showing her toe with bright red toenail polish, was squeezing her toe like she was trying to make it look red. But the officer wrote no injury was visible. So she, this woman, was out to just, you know, just make money off of this.
Well, first of all, I mean, if she had a concern, I mean, I could see somebody from, like, New England, say, not used to lizards running around, being concerned about contracting something. I mean, God knows, you know, Tara from RDA has been in the hospital with an infected spider bite, and infections can be bad. But, you know, it, and yes, iguanas, you know, malfridges can cut you. I have been bitten by an iguana, and that happened. Mm-hmm. So I went to the nurse, and I put some peroxide on it and some Neosporin, and I put a Band-Aid on it. And I went back to what I was doing.
Yeah, that's what happened. Two other women at the resort told Sellers that Russell was pushing her foot toward the iguana, antagonizing it. Sure enough, a video taken of the alleged poolside attack shows her repeatedly shoving her foot towards the animal to the point where the iguana wrapped its mouth around her toe. This last line, when I originally read it, broke me. The iguana wasn't charged.
I love when they do something like that. It's just such a, like, you know, like that snake, this was years and years ago, that the snake that was crawling into a hen house and eating the eggs. So the farmer put light bulbs out, and it ate the light bulbs, and they had to have surgery to have the light bulbs removed. And they said the snake was released for further reconnaissance.
Oh, damn.
I love that. I love when they do that. What does she think? She thinks she's gonna, like, sue the... What did she... Like, what outcome was expected here?
I don't know. I guess sue for negligence and get a whole shit ton of money. I don't know.
Sue for lizard? I mean...
This is like back in the the 1300s when towns would get blighted with crickets and they would try to sue the crickets to make them go away.
No, you're chirping a little too loudly, Mr. Cricket. I'm going to sue you. Can you imagine? Okay, what's on the docket today? We have, all right, a child molestation case on today.
Okay, witchcraft.
We've got witchcraft here, and we've got the case of Mrs. Tidy Whitey versus Chirpy the Cricket, who is in fact an actual cricket.
Hartlepool in England, during the French Revolution, a French ship was foundered in a storm, and everyone aboard died, and the ship ran aground in Hartlepool in England. And the only creature that they found alive on the ship was a monkey that had been the pet of, obviously, someone on the ship. But because the British propaganda, you know, was in the newspapers and stuff, drew, you know, the French like monkeys, they thought that it was an escaped French soldier, so they put the monkey on trial, and then they hanged the monkey for espionage.
What?
This is really true. This is true. That's why the Hartlepool, their football team, it's a hanged monkey. Hanged monkey is their thing. I'm totally, look this up. This really happened.
Well then.
They hung the monkey.
They hung the monkey.
They thought it was a French soldier, and they hung the monkey.
I don't know if you guys are on Facebook right now, but I just saw this thing. There's that game between Washington and Arizona, I think that's later tonight. Mm-hmm. Apparently, there was a rally earlier today of Native Americans supporting the Redskins.
Okay.
Like the one?
No, there's like... hold on, I'll show you this picture, because there's like a whole bunch of people there, and there's a bunch of other pictures.
Oh dear, but all right. While you pull that up there, we're actually just about out of time, so we're gonna go ahead and get out of here. Hopefully, he'll have the picture up, and then we can like put it up and shit and post or whatever. So anyway,
don't hang any monkeys, everybody.
Yeah, don't hang
play
monkeys.
Play it safe.
No,
it's hang elephants instead.
Alrighty, so if we wanted to find Mr. Mendo on the social media and everywhere, where could we find him?
You can find me on Twitter at Michael A. Novelli. Find me on Facebook as just Michael Novelli, or you can go to my Facebook group, Mr. Mendo. You can find me and my show on agonybooth.com, Vimeo, YouTube, and this new thing they have in England called Zipline, but I only have two videos up there so far.
Well, that'd be an interesting thing to
look at. I do have a... a review that should finally be done within the next couple of days. I realize I said that last time I was on this show, but I got sick and I didn't finish it. So my review of Who's Nailin' Palin should be ready in the next couple of days.
Sweet.
Check it out on rtgomer.com, at the Agni booth, and various other places I'm going to post it.
Awesome. And where could we find Omega?
Oh, you know me. I'm on Twitter at the Omega Geek and the Omega Geek.com. I do some columns sometimes for Nerdvice. I'm on RT Gomer Prod. You can also find Lesbian Talk on thatguywiththeglasses.com. And I do things with my good lady wife, Diamanda Hagen, and you know her. She's all around.
Yes. Oh, as for me, you can find me on the social media on Twitter and Tumblr at Gomer21XX. You can find my stuff on rtgomer.com and nerdvice.com. And also this very show, if you're not already listening to it on iTunes, you can find it there. Just look up Thespian Talk and you'll be able to find it, as well as both of my other podcasts. And if you like this show and you like the other stuff that I do and want to help contribute to, you know, do just expenses of, you know, living expenses or upkeep expenses or whatever, then head on over to my Patreon, patreon.com/gomer21XX. And for as little as a dollar, you could get early access to new episodes. You get monthly video vlog from yours truly and a few other things I'm trying to work on. I'm revamping some of the rewards here and there to make it a little bit better and a little bit more exciting. And also, if you want some really awesome artwork or some just kick-ass animation, then check out my girlfriend's Patreon page. Her name is Becky Hopkins. You can find her at patreon.com/BeckyHop. Go over there. She has links to her DeviantArt, to her personal site. And if you throw enough money at her, she will do a 30-second animation for you. And it is awesome.
And she's an award winner, is she not?
She is an award-winning animator. That she is. But again, that is patreon.com/BeckyHop. And with that, we are going to get out of here. And next time, we're actually starting the next show. We're actually going to do a little bit of a change in a few things. And we'll let you know when that actually happens. So look forward to that, I guess.
I don't have a Patreon, but if you just want to give me money, I'll take it.
There you go.
Yeah, seriously.
You know, hey, kindness of strangers is always good. You know, especially if it's just pure kindness. So, and it all is very much appreciated.
We have always relied upon the kindness of Patreons.
Yes.
Or patrons, I guess.
There you go. All right. And with that, this has been Gomer the Ranting Thespian with the Omega and Mr. Mendo.
The Internet's strongest man.
Yes. Take care, everybody. Signing off.
Bye.
See ya.
Thespian Talk is an RT Gomer Productions presentation. Check us out at rtgomer.com.